Growing up in the countryside, it was John Peel. He wrote in The Observer that if he wasn't around, I should be inheriting his show, which is about the ultimate compliment. I'm slightly embarrassed even to say it. Well, I used to go to Killing Joke when they started, when youth was a youth. We went to Africa together in 2001, solar eclipse in Zambia. Came into each other's orbits. 1999 eclipse in England. I kind of knew that it would be a disaster in England, which it was. So I went to Hungary, which was the first Azora party. Never looked back, so I've been doing eclipses ever since then. Tonight's a lunar eclipse. Plus Matt Black I've known for 30 years. 30 years ago we were on the same pirate radio station. In fact, they were the first DJs that I knew was Matt and John. They came around my house in like 86. It was kind of transformative. Moment. Coldcut were very inspirational because they were the first British DJs to say, okay, we're going to make our own records. Up to that point, dance music was an American thing. Hip-hop was an American thing until the mid-80s, and then it was like people in England said, well, fuck it, why can't we do this? Out of the circle with Coldcut, and then in the 10 years later, I ended up signing to Ninja Tune. Not with Ninja Tune anymore, but I still see a lot of Matt and his lovely wife, Dinaz. Started off on the 70s in a punk band, then was roadie for The Clash for a very short time. Came to London around 1980, and samplers in the mid-80s, and started doing remixes on my Commodore 64 computer and things like that. I used to write for computer music press in those days and review software and things like that. Spent the 80s saying, this is the future of music, you know, and everyone else was still playing the guitars, having indie bands. Started making records with Irresistible Force in like the late 80s, and then I joined the Shaman as like the tour DJ at the end of 89. I spent 2 years doing this synergy club around Europe for the Shaman, and that really threw me in the deep end as a DJ, because up to that point I was more interested in making my own music and DJing wasn't so important. Then I really got into it. So after the Shaman I signed with Rising High Records and I made two albums for them, Flying High, Global Tillage. Those were a big success. Then I made the Dreamfish album with Pete Namlook. By sort of 93 I was writing for Mixmag, ID, NME. So I broke lots and lots of acts like Aphex Twin, Paul to Canada, Matthew Herbert. All kinds of people would never have got their first press. Luke Vibert. I ran the Chill Out show on Kiss FM. It was the first Chill Out radio show. It was pretty much ruling things by about 93. It was a good time. I remember the early 90s as being a really great time for music. Just so many amazing parties where anything seemed possible. I was always involved in Berlin. In the late 80s I was playing at big parties in Berlin. And then when the Love Parade started, my friend Dr. Motta started Love Parade. He invited me to do the Chill Out stage at Love Parade. We watched Love Parade grow from like 10,000 people to a million in like 4 years, 5 years. It just went out of control. We lost control of it. Yeah, I spent a lot of time in Japan. I first went 93 and had one track on a compilation in Japan. Club Yellow was like a very famous club in the 90s. They did a night called Eden in the Sky. It was kind of the echoes of Megatripolis, which I was doing in London at the time. Techno music, but also ambient music and also inspirational speakers. John Lilly came out and did a lecture. Eno and Fripp, The Orb did a gig. Bill Nelson, Terence McKenna. There was nothing like it in Japan before. I was very determined, like, let's make an impact with this one gig, because I might never come here again. So I arranged for a Buddhist choir to come on stage. We had 24 Buddhist monks as my support act. At the end of the show, I got on the mic and invited the whole audience to come across the road to this bar called Tantra. And then I did ambience all night in the bar. And that was the first time anyone had done an ambient party in Tokyo. And still working with people that I met on that night, so it was worth doing. Mookie was the organiser of that party, and he knew some Buddhist sect. Japanese religion, they have Shintoism and they have Buddhism. Shintoism is tolerant. It's not all about you mustn't do this, you mustn't do that. Even though it's so ancient, it coexists with the modern world. They have drive-in temples, so you can drive your car in and they bless your car, they'll pass the MOT.
If they could bless my VW Beetle and that was my MOT pass.
Apparently the secret is they put a sticker on the car, and when the inspectors see the sticker, they're more likely to pass you because you've been blessed. I want to play at Tenkawa Jinja. Jinja, so it's a shrine, Shinto. Terra is Buddhist and Jinja is Shinto. This temple, they have once a year a big gig. In fact, Brian Eno played there, Jean-Michel Jarre played there. The head monk invites one artist to come and present a night of music at the shrine. It's quite remote, it's in Wakayama Prefecture. Never been to that part of Japan.
What really kind of makes you tick as a person?
Music. And food. Can't live without either of those. Me and John Peel used to play on stage 2 at Glastonbury, like 93, 94, 95. Because I used to work for CND, I made 2 compilations for CND. CND used to be the beneficiaries of Glastonbury. All the money would go to CND. Nowadays it goes to Greenpeace and Oxfam. I played before the Prodigy on Saturday night, and they were like an hour late coming on. So I had about 100,000 people. It was like as far as the eye can see. So that's probably the biggest crowd that I've played. It was a strange feeling. It was only supposed to be 15 minutes, but it just went on and on and on. They were late coming on. I don't know what they were doing. Casper Parent signed me, and then I brought in a lot of other acts. And the ambient side of Rising High brought in a lot of the artists. Suddenly we were selling more ambient records than hardcore. Rising High started out as like really hard rave music. A lot of people were amazed when we suddenly started doing a completely different thing, changed the image of the label completely. By about 94, the 3 big electronic music labels were Warp, R&S and Rising High, and all 3 signed a deal with Sony in Japan. This was the moment when electronic music boomed in Japan, is when Sony picked up the catalogues of those 3 labels and released them in Japan. So I got like a major label release in Japan. That's really the moment when Japanese electronic music scene started to grow up. It was those deals that made it happen. Because Sony was behind it, adverts on every magazine with the whole Rising High and Warp catalogues. So we all started to sell lots of records in Japan. Yeah. Because I was writing for British press, I started to break Japanese acts in the UK. First of all, this guy Kenichi, he made some records on a small label in Holland, and I made a big fuss about them in the press. And then R&S picked him up, and he became the biggest DJ in Japan for a while. R&S spent a fortune getting the director of Akira to make the animated video for Kenichi's single. That was big news in Japan as well. The electronic music scene in Japan is so big now, it's hard to imagine a time when there wasn't one. Japanese electronic music goes back to Yellow Magic Orchestra, of course. They were the only Japanese band ever to have a hit in America and England. Before that, there was experimental electronic music, but it was definitely YMO who were like the Kraftwerk of Japan. I'm doing an album for youth. I put down some tracks at his place in London. All summer I've been doing festivals and gigs, so I'd like to make a lot more music. I've been much more doing DJing than making music the last decade. I actually was the most played chill-out DJ in the world on Mixcloud. And last year they announced that I was number 2, and then a couple of days later the guy who was number 1 got disqualified because he didn't do the mixes. He was taking other people's mixes and claiming them as his own. So I won it again last year. For 15 years I did the Big Chill Festival, which Pete Lawrence founded. I was involved in it from the very beginning. And that just started out like this, with we took a couple of hundred mates to Wales and did a party in the Black Mountains, 95. Only one stage, one truck of food, one bar. It soon grew into a big festival, an interference festival. An ambient weekend during Love Parade, and put on all the ambient electronic artists for 3 days. Berlin had never seen anything like it. Still got all the posters from Interference. People still talking about those. Be good to bring that one back and do like a 20th anniversary Interference party. I had more people call me about this party than almost anything this summer.
Here's the man himself.
Just caught a little bit of that. All sounded great. Flamenco sound.
I was looking at some 2 days ago. The only connection I have with Spanish music really is because the Spanish Civil War. So I have like albums of Spanish Civil War songs and things.
Would that be good?
Yeah, a bit of that here.
There's to the left.
Exactly.
How are ya?
Good.
Beautiful.
Growing up in the countryside, it was John Peel. You couldn't go to gigs when you were in the countryside. This is the 70s. And I listened to John Peel for years and years, and he taught you a lot of lessons. If he played a record, it was a hit. If he didn't play it, then it disappeared without trace. He had amazing power. He did a lot for my career, because he booked me to do sessions in 91 and 92. He was one of the first British electronic acts to do Peel sessions. And of course, we ended up playing together at Glastonbury. So we talk a lot. I was writing for the NME, and everything that I wrote, I would send it to him. Sometimes he would play it on his show, and we collaborated on pushing some acts like Aphex Twin, Black Dog and Square Pusher. He wrote in The Observer that if he wasn't around, I should be inheriting his show, which is about the ultimate compliment. I'm slightly embarrassed even to say it. I'd like to go back to radio. I used to do a show on Kiss, of course, and I did the Solid Steel show for Ninja Tune for a while. I've got a perfect face for radio, as they say. Da 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 da